Show me your face. Let me hear your voice. I don't want to have a conversation with you from three rooms away. I want to see you. I want to hear you. I want to remove distractions. I want to get rid of the children and the technology. And it's going to be you and I, eyeball to eyeball, having a conversation. And then when you do speak, I'm going to be the safe spouse. Your voice is sweet and your face is lovely.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
Ted Cunningham is our guest speaker today with great advice on how to be a good listener, a skill I think we can all improve upon. Ted is the founding pastor of Woodland Hills Family Church in Branson, Missouri, and the author of several books on marriage and family relationships. Here's Ted speaking to our staff at a recent Focus on the Family chapel.
A journey I've been on for about the last year and a half is to become a better listener. How many of you think you're awesome listeners? Would you raise your hand? How many of you think you just have a little bit of improvement, but you're not a terrible listener, but you could get better? Okay, it's the rest of us. So this is the journey I'm on, because about a year and a half ago, I asked my wife and son at lunch. I sat down, I said, scale of 1 to 10, and I was enthusiastic about it, scale of 1 to 10, how good of a listener am I? And my wife, this is over lunch, immediately said, 5. And I said, well, why don't we take the lunch time? Think about it a little bit. You don't need to give me an answer. I don't need it right now. I said, Carson, he's my 13-year-old. I go, how am I doing listening? He said, about a 5. And I mean, they could see it all over me, like, this is not good. This is not, I was expecting more. My wife's nickname for me is Marriage Boy. I got to be doing better than a 5. And Amy could see this was really working me over. So she came into the rescue right away. She said, now I will tell you, when we have your undivided attention, I'd give you an 8. So that's good. I know that's exactly what I need to do. Be focused, be in. I said, Carson, what do you think I should do? And without batting an eye, he goes, Dad, the next time I ask for money, listen. Not at all the point of that exercise. So I've been working this out in my own life for the last year and a half, trying to work my way toward an 8. Being a 5 listener. So this afternoon I want to talk to you about how to help your spouse win every argument. How you can be a great listener. And if you listen well, it's interesting, the issues just kind of go away. I've noticed this over the last year and a half. If I'm fully engaged in the conversation, I'm not distracted, I'm not thinking about something else, I'm not distracted by the environment, I can be fully engaged in the conversation and let Amy know I'm here, I'm present. It's amazing how quickly we just move away from whatever it was we were about to have conflict over. And I said, okay, so here, I am going to become a professional listener. This is my goal. I hope this becomes your goal. You want high levels of marital satisfaction? Listening beyond a 5. That's all I'm here to tell you. Listening beyond a 5. Marital satisfaction depends on factors and skills couples can do something about in any season or stage of life. And so I've been honing in on the listening skill. How to increase my marital satisfaction by becoming a better listener. And I take you to the Song of Solomon chapter 2, verse 14, where Solomon is speaking to the Shulamite woman. They're not yet married. They get married in the next chapter. But this is what he says. My dove. Let's stop right there. Guys, if you don't have a pet name for your wife, go with my dove. It works. And here's all you need to do to begin the conversation. Coo. Coo. I'm not kidding. Listen, I don't know if your wife ever tries to have a conversation with you from three rooms away. This is the most exhausting thing about trying to communicate in a home. I hear her from another room, and this is all I hear. And it goes on. I used to say, what? And she'd launch right back into, we want to do it, then we go and get the line. You know what I do now when she's three rooms away and she starts a conversation that I can't understand? Ooh. Ooh. It's my dove call. It works. Look at my dove in the clefts of the rock and the hiding places on the mountainside. He's wanting to get to know her. It doesn't say my mountain lion. It doesn't say a snake. Solomon uses a gentle, tender dove. And she's back into the hiding places on the mountainside. And he wants to draw her out. How do you draw out a dove? You don't just go in there and start jabbing to try to get it. You're gentle. You're tender. You're kind. Ooh. Ooh. Show me your face. Let me hear your voice. I don't want to have a conversation with you from three rooms away. Come in here. I want to see you. I want to hear you. I want to remove distractions. I want to get rid of the children and the technology and everything. They're going to be out, and it's going to be you and I, eyeball to eyeball, having a conversation. And then when you do speak, I'm going to be the safe spouse. Your voice is sweet, and your face is lovely. Coo. Coo. I love this. I was just in Louisiana teaching them how to do the dove call, and one guy came up to me after the session. He goes, Pastor, you do that around here, you're going to get shot. But what Solomon is speaking about here, we read these three great word pictures in Proverbs. Proverbs 3:3 speaks of the heart as a tablet, that messages are written on the tablet of the heart. Proverbs 4:23 talks about the heart being a wellspring. Every word you speak and every action you take, it flows from your heart. And then, Proverbs 20, verse 5, the heart is like deep waters. And a person of understanding is able to draw them out. I love all of this imagery, from the dove to deep waters. I want to be a person of understanding, a person of insight in my marriage. So I just want to listen. But we're losing the listening skill in our culture today. I think we're getting worse at listening. But listening is the fast track to your spouse's heart, to the deep waters. We live in a day where we get our news from algorithms on social media and cable news networks that reinforce our biases, which means we're only wanting to listen to news we agree with. How's that working in your marriage and in your family? I'll listen to you when I agree with you. Do you remember when we used to watch the news to find out what was going on? Now we turn it on to figure out, what should I be mad about today? And it just gets us all spun up and all fired up. Social media, it's the same. You know, social media has become this place where it allows us to share our opinions without sticking around for the conversation. Ah, again, it's just going against our communication skills. Adam Donye, a teaching pastor at our church, he uses the illustration of, you know, pretend this table's talking, you know, at the end, and you're having a great conversation, and I hear what the issue is, but I haven't heard anything that you have said, and I come walking by in just a moment, and I just blah my opinion onto the table and keep walking. That's social media. I get to post my opinion, but I don't have to stick around to hear what you think or how this makes you feel. We're losing that skill. Healthy people, or the scripture, I'll start with this, Proverbs 18:2. A fool takes no pleasure in understanding, but only in expressing his opinion. Healthy people are not threatened by the opinions of others. I'll bring this back to marriage. A healthy husband is not threatened by the opinions of his wife. A healthy wife is not threatened by the opinions of her husband. Listening to you does not mean that I agree with you. And this is the big one. Disagreeing with you doesn't mean that I hate you. It just means I have a difference of opinion. You know what listening does? Listening screams, you matter to me. Listening screams, I want to get to know you. I want to find out what's in your heart. And I can't do that as a husband when I'm running my mouth. This may shock you, but I'm the talker in our family. And as Christmas approaches, I couldn't quite grasp this. Amy and I, we've always had very different opinions on how Christmas should be celebrated. Very different. My wife grew up in a home where there was garland over every door, a tree in every room. You can't start decorating until just the right cookie is being baked in the oven. And the Christmas, Bing Crosby is playing on the the radio. And I never understood when we got married why I was so angry every December. Like, I just like, why by the time I pull the 46 box down out of the attic that says Christmas decor on it, I'm in no mood to celebrate the birth of my Lord and Savior. I'm ticked. You know why? It's all about the heart, the tablet of the heart. The message on Amy's heart is Christmas is celebrated long and with lots of money. I'm sorry, I have to do this in a place that screams I'm learning. But I never could figure out when our kids would come over with an ornament that they made the year before and be like, hey Dad, I made this ornament last year, put it on the tree. Like, what? Where did that just come from? Well, it came from my heart. You know what my heart says? My heart says Christmas isn't that big of a deal. You know why? My family, we decorated for Christmas on a commercial break. My dad, while we're watching That's Incredible, would say, hey, we should probably decorate for Christmas. And he'd go over to the crawl space, take the pegboard off the crawl space, reach in, grab a 3-foot pre-decorated tree with a garbage bag over it, put it on the humidifier, and we'd take it off. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Year after year after year of that, the message on my heart was, Christmas just isn't that big of a deal. On Amy's heart, the message is, Christmas is big. You start planning it in the summer, and you launch it the morning after Halloween. This is why we moved to Branson, Missouri. We celebrate Christmas for 3 months in Branson. It's a big deal for her. But I don't have to change that in her. But now my wife's way better at listening. I give her an 8 or 9. Way better at listening than me. She's the one that listened to my heart to find out, why are you so angry with decorating for Christmas? Healthy people can decorate for Christmas without escalated arguments. I said, not where I grew up, no. But she would listen, try to figure out, and then we figured it out. The way our family decorated year after year after year wrote these messages on the tablet, the wellspring, the deep waters of our hearts. Listening and understanding your feelings doesn't mean I agree with your opinions. Amy and I still don't 100% align on things. She's the same way with birthdays. Birthdays are a big deal. The message on her heart, birth weeks are very important in the life. And I grew up with a mom and a dad who loved me, but birthdays, we didn't have big parties. My mom and dad would put a 10 or a 20 on the table and yell up the stairs, happy birthday, son. Years of that. How many of you grew up the same way? It was just similar. It's just put a message on your heart, and now you get married, you bring your family of origin, and she brings her family of origin, and we have differences of opinion. But the quality of our marriage and the level of marital satisfaction for us is when we listen to get into the heart, to the tablet, to the wellspring, to the deep waters, to find out what's going on. And when we do find out what's going on, we live with fascination, not trying to change each other, but we have these aha moments. Have you ever been at your in-law's house and they say or do something and you're like, huh? That's why. Like you've been married for 10, 20 years and you could never figure out this one argument or what was going on, and then something is said or done and you're like, my husband watched that for 20 years, and it wrote a message on his heart. My wife heard you say that over and over and over and over again, and wrote a message on her heart. See, the fun of marriage is discovering those messages, and you can't discover them when your mouth is running, and all God's people said. It's about listening. Listening to you, Amy, does not mean I need to solve your problem. It means I'm just getting to know you and that you matter to me. Here's a big one. I can listen to your opinions, Amy, without seeing it as an attack on mine. I'm just going to listen. I want to be a healthy listener, not threatened by the opinions of everyone else. But there's a lot of bad listening styles that I have. I came up with about 12 of them, and after sharing these for a couple of months now, people have brought me more, so the list has grown to 15. And these would represent 15 bad listeners. And I'm just going to give them to you in rapid fire. I'm about 5 of these 15. You may be several of them. You may be one of them, major. But I'm just going to run through them. The first bad listener is what I would call the nodder. if you've ever seen the nodder, it's the person that always, when you're trying to talk to them, they're going, It's the person who took a management course at work. And in that course, they were told, when someone is speaking, give them an emotional cue or a signal. Be responsive. And the person never quite learned how to bring balance to that. And so when you're trying to talk to them, all you get is, And you're like, I'm done with this conversation. This is too much. Nodders. You can nod to let them know you're, just bring it down a notch. That's all we're asking. The eye roller. The eye roller. The conversation hasn't even started yet, but just the mere mention of we're going into this conversation about money or about in-laws or about jobs. I'm an eye roller. And I don't think anything communicates contempt more than an eye roll. And it's not just, I don't want to listen to you talk about this. You got to go deeper than that. I don't want to listen to you. Right? That's what contempt is. Contempt goes past a person's opinion, right, to their soul, to their character, to who they are. The eye wanderer. This is the person that's looking for a better conversation. Person looking for something better to do. The bored. This is the person, the lights are on, but no one's home. They're not fully there and engaged. I'm the distracted listener. The distracted listener is distracted one of two ways, either by everything going on in their mind and all of their lists that are constantly running, or by their environment. I can be distracted by both. Noisy restaurants are not great places for me to try to engage in a deep conversation because I'm so distracted by everything going on. The watch glancer. This is the one that, I mean, nothing says rude more than looking at your watch while someone is sharing their heart with you. And whenever someone does that to me, I just tap on their watch and go, I'll be done in just a second. The watch glancer. The new one is the scroller. This is the person that in the middle of a conversation, they take their phone out and start scrolling. The next three, the one-upper. You've heard of the one-upper. It's like if you've been there, they've been there far more times than you have. It was a better trip. They've done it more. They've been there more. They love it more. And that you can never get one up with them. Or the one downer. We don't talk about this one a whole bunch. The one downer is the person, and I deal with this a lot with senior adults. You hear them talking about their illnesses, and they're trying to one down each other. And you'll hear, I'm from Branson. We minister to a lot of senior adults. But you'll hear a guy go, man, I'm not feeling well. You're not feeling well today. You don't know what not feeling well is. And then they start discussing very inappropriate things with one another. It's like, we're not competing over your sicknesses here and your illness. But maybe you come home from work and you're married to a one downer and you're like, I had a rough day. You had a rough day. You have no idea what I put up with at work or what I put up with around here. The overvalidator. Oh, this is one. I actually got this from a friend. Recently, she said, Ted, you need to add this to your list. They've been through several miscarriages as a couple, and she said over our last one, and these are, I mean, Amy and I walked through this with them, but they're heart-wrenching. And she said, Ted, the number of people that stopped by to visit me and to share their story with me. So we read in Galatians, every man must carry his own load, but we're to carry each other's burdens. She said, I finally had to tell someone who came in to validate what I was going through, but they didn't see what they were doing. They're just putting more and more on me. She said, I finally put my hands up to this person and said, whoa. I mean, this was like a day after they lost their child. She said, whoa, please don't. I'm already carrying such a load right now. I can't carry any of yours. The over-validator, the person who thinks they're helping, but they're not really, let's just listen. As I shared this at a church in Houston a couple months ago, a lady said, Ted, I didn't realize that it could be of any value, but we have dear friends who just lost a son to brittle bone disease. And when my husband called me and said, we need to go over and be with them, we walked in and the husband was in the family room and my husband stayed with him and he told me that his wife was back in the bedroom on the bed there crying. And she said, Ted, all I knew to do was to just lay down in bed next to her. And said, for 3 hours, she said, I had to fight through awkward moments of where I feel like I should say something right now, I should do something right now. But she said, for 3 hours, I didn't say anything. And I told her, what a great ministry you had that day. The bottom liner. Bottom liner is the person that you've been into the story long enough, they got enough information, let's be done with it. The interviewer. The interviewer comes to the conversation with a plan and with questions. And if you've been around an interviewer, it can be quite exhausting where they're like, okay, next question, and they don't allow you to finish one question before they're launching into the next question. It can drain the energy. The hijacker. We've been listening to you long enough, it's my turn. The debater. The debater is always trying to shoot holes in your logic. Or you share something you heard. Where did you hear that? They want like you to cite what you just came up with. And then the sentence completer. The sentence completer is the one who you're not even through, you're not even finished, and they're finishing the sentences for you. And you know, Amy admits she can be a sentence completer, and we were years ago getting ready in the bathroom, and she was on the other side of the shower curtain, and we're having a great conversation. I thought, oh, this is a good time to go make the coffee, because I thought the conversation was over. And I go down to the kitchen, I make a pot of coffee, I'm pouring the coffee, I come walking back down, I set the coffee down, but as I'm walking back towards the bathroom, I realize, wow, there is still a conversation going on in the bathroom. So I come racing back in there and I set the coffee down. And if your husband's ever had this moment where he's like, he's just trying to process what's going on. Before he speaks, he wants to know what happened. I'll tell you what happened. I left and she didn't see me leave because she's on the other side of the curtain. While I was gone, she asked me a question. And I wasn't there, which was no big deal. She answered the question for me. Okay. She did not like my answer. And I'm like, what just sentence completer? My wife has a resting smile. I wish I had a resting smile. I don't have a resting smile. And people will tell me, you know, sometimes when you talk, even when you're being funny, you need to smile. And so I catch myself, even in the middle of sermons, main points, like serious points, having this brief moment where I'm like, ooh, I should probably smile. So I do this. But she has a resting smile. My wife's a great listener. My wife doesn't need to talk. We're coming into a holiday where, you know, lots of family around the table, and she loves just listening to people, knowing this is a skill I need to work on. A few more passages to share with you. Proverbs 15:30 says, "Bright eyes gladden the heart. A joyful heart makes a cheerful face." So I've been working for us on the point of reconnection at the end of the day, like when we see each other after the end of a long day, to just not be that one who walks in and throws stuff down and tends to stuff, gets the garbage and changes the light bulb and takes in the mail and starts flipping through the mail. The first thing I want to do to show her, I'm listening. Now, I walk in and I give her bright eyes. So she's across the kitchen and I walk in, and this is all you do, guys. You walk in and you just go. You tilt the head back and forth a little bit. The Blue Man Group is a show where they go an hour and a half with using nothing but the eyes. So I'll walk into the kitchen and you kind of got to make a quick little in like that. We're in the same room. Then Song of Solomon chapter 2 verse 6. His left arm is under my head. His right arm embraces me. So here's what I do. I walk in, I see her. And then I walk over to her, and I put my left hand right there behind her head. Are you paying attention, guys? This is big. You're going to do this tonight when you leave. And you bring her down to here. And what does it say? His right arm embraces me. Look how biblical this is. Let's do it again. Let's walk through it one more time. And you look her right in the eyes, and you say, "Coo, coo." Thank you, Focus. It's been great being with you this afternoon.
That was such a fun day with Ted, and I hope you've been inspired to listen with an open heart to the thoughts and feelings of the people you care about. Here at Focus on the Family, we want to listen to you. Over the past year, we've helped over 700,000 couples build stronger marriages or get through a major marital crisis. And if you donate to this ministry, let me say thank you for helping us make that happen. And please remember that we're here for you if you need help. Just call us and we'll take it from there. And if you want to help marriages thrive, please donate today. And when you make a donation of any amount, we'll send you a CD of this message from Ted Cunningham so that you can share it with your spouse or with a friend.
Make your monthly pledge or one-time gift and request that CD by clicking on the link below or by calling 800, the letter A in the word family, 800-232-6459. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back when we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.